Happy New Year, everyone. Today is Thursday, January 5th, 2017. We have a lot of bullshit to talk about. We got bullshit, and more bullshit, and more topics to discuss. So stay where you are, and we'll be right back. GAYXYZ.
I'm so fresh, man. Man, y'all scared to do it how I do it.
Like I'm Jordan, Mally, come swing the thing right by me. Got a joint if you wanna get stoned. Got choppers if they wanna try me. Bro, athlete, I'm not no wannabe. Waitress asked how many bottles, I said 23.
Put on my jeans,
like me. J's on my feet, you know. J's on my feet, J's on my feet.
Yes, sir.
So get like me. I stay showing out. My kick game is a beast. I got 30 pair of J's that ain't even been released. Blue game 12, Space Jam 11. All the hype be sick. They gon' need a paramedic. Turn up. I get trippy, I stay live. All this purple in my cup, match them great fives. I'm so high. I got three bitches that go by. I'm so fly, I'm getting head like a blow.
Hi, everybody. Welcome to GAYXYZ. That song was chosen by Jason. So thank you, Jason, for that. 23 by featuring Miley Cyrus, Wiz Khalifa, and Juicy J, whoever the fuck they are. Anyway, that was a good song. I like you liked it.
My ratchet people know who they are. My ratchet folks know who they are.
I liked it, actually. It was actually a good beat. I liked it. I don't know what the fuck they were talking about.
I feel like I'm having a Mariah moment right now.
What do you mean?
The sound, it sounds, it's really weird on my end. But okay, I'll just...
You said
I'll
that last week, too, and it was just fine when it was recorded, so it's got to be on your side, darling. Sorry.
Okay, so I'll just endure.
Do you, if you need a break or something...
I'm going to stand there and look for my ear monitor while you're talking.
Okay, that's cool, that's cool. Welcome to GAYXYZ, everybody. It is Tuesday, January 5th, 2017. This is our first show of the year. The new...
Happy New Year!
Year, yes, and... What did you do for the new year, Jason?
I did absolutely nothing. I stayed home.
Yeah.
I didn't do anything. I stayed home with my dog. I got my dog some dog wine. Yes, they do sell that. And I got myself some wine. And we turned up and then passed out.
Okay. Well, that sounds fun.
People wanted me to go out, but I just wasn't in the mood this year for some reason.
I wasn't in the mood to go out at all. I mean, we didn't go out at all. We just stayed in, and it was me and my my mom and my husband and our friend Kathy and our friend Ken, and we just played games and drank a lot and had Ken made tons of, like, hors d'oeuvres. He made, like, these awesome little cream puff things, like, oh, stuffed jalapenos with cream cheese in them, and he made all this, like, this cheese tray and stuffed ravioli and, like, all this other stuff. Just this really nice. It was a huge spread. I think I took a picture. But anyway, it was really good. So we had that, and I had champagne, two bottles of wine. Wait, two bottles of wine or three bottles of wine? I can't remember. Champagne.
Sounds like you just had a gay old evening.
And tequila. I had my tequila, too, yes. So it was fun. We had a fun time, and then we rang in the new year. But this year, being 2017, you know, it is a new year, which means, you know, I think it's really important that we as humans have this tradition, because I think it helps us, if not literally, you know, figuratively, or in our minds at least, kind of wipe away all the past transgressions or the bullshit from the year before that we've had to endure. And so I'm really happy that we have this tradition. So I'm glad every year comes and it lets me just like kind of do like this, just like, you know, psh, psh, wipe my hands clean, I'm done, moving on. That's how I think about it. And people don't want to be in your life anymore, or I say fuck them. So why do you want people in your life who don't want to be in your life anyway? That's what I say.
Right.
Anyway.
So here's my new saying for 2017.
Oh, what's that?
Compliments of Issa Rae on Insecure.
Yes. Which I told you about, by the way.
Yes, which I love. If you haven't seen it, watch it. It's hilarious. So my new saying for 2017, when someone says something crazy or something that I don't believe, I say, bish what?
Bish what?
Yeah. B-I-S-H.
Right.
And W-H-E-T.
Right.
Bish what?
Oh, you know what I thought was so funny of that, though, was, what was the song? The pussy song? It was, maybe your pussy's depressed or
yeah,
whatever.
Your pussy's broken or something.
Oh, pussy's broken. It was the funniest little rap song. It was so fucking hilarious. But anyway, but that's a good show. Anyway, so topics wise, this week
we have a lot, people. We have a lot. A lot has happened in the past week.
Let's start with Kim Burrell.
This bitch, that whore, Kim Burrell. So for people who do not know who Kim Burrell is, Kim Burrell is a pastor. She first started as a she performed with a choir in her hometown of Houston, Texas, and that's where she still lives.
Oh, is she from Houston? Lovely.
Yeah. And then I guess she became, you know, more famous, and then she, you know, eventually, you know, kind of snowballed from there, where she ended up having her own church and her own sermon, and, you know, the popularity just kind of grew from that.
Oh, so she's not just a gospel singer, she's a pastor.
Right.
Wow. Okay.
So for those who have been living under a rock for the past week, Kim Burrell pretty much came out and made some very homophobic statements.
Saying that we're against God. And...
Yes. And she was supposed to do this like days before she was supposed to appear on the Ellen show.
Right.
So for those, she was doing a sermon in church, and I'm assuming someone with a cell phone was recording, because, you know, everyone does that now. And whoever recorded this recorded her saying some very hurtful things. One of the quotes is, "I came to tell you that homosexuality is a sin. It is a perverted homosexual spirit and the spirit of delusion and confusion. It has deceived many women and men. And then she tried to come out later with this, like, this rebuttal and was like, oh, I really didn't say that. She said, I didn't say about any particular. She said, I didn't say. Well, she said, she said something about, I didn't say gays or lesbians. I said homosexuals. I'm like, bitch, that's the same
fucking
thing.
That's the same thing, dumbass.
That's the same thing. There's a video going around, and she tried to, like, you know, somewhat backtrack. I'm like, bitch, it's already out there. There's documented footage of you saying
that. That's like saying, oh, I hate all black people, but I didn't say anything about Nigerians or people from the Sudan. It's like, you know what I mean? It's like, what the fuck? Dumbass bitch. Anyway.
Yeah, and then she says something, and then it says, she took the Facebook Live, and then later this is what she said. She said, there are a lot of people that I'm aware of the struggle ordeal. Wait, let me read that back. It says, there are a lot of people that I'm aware of the struggle or deal with that, or that have that spirit. She said, have I discriminated against them? Have I ever outright told them that I don't love you and they're going to hell? I don't recall. That's what she's saying. She said, I don't recall. So pretty much she's saying that now. She's saying that she didn't discriminate against them or that type of thing. I'm like, bitch, yes, you did. You said it's perverted.
Well, this is the thing I have with and this is, you know, I'm very, very anti-religion anyway. But when it comes to black people, my dad, I've told you before, is a deacon or pastor or some shit. I don't know the difference. But anyway, he's something in a church like that high up that talks to people all the time. Anyway, and he's got his own little church and shit and here in Dallas. And he's completely the same way and believes the same bullshit. And it seems to be just like it is, like racism is institutional or is inherent in a lot of people who are like rednecks or people from certain parts of the country. I think homophobia is in the black community. It's just because the church is so integral in my experience anyway, in the black community, and in the culture of the black community, because of that. And because a lot of people who believe in that believe that being gay is wrong as a result of it, therefore are homophobic. And so she is just the apex and the epitome of what the problem is in the black community. And it's hatred for gay people.
But here's my thing though. It's, first of all, I do not believe that you're truly a quote unquote word of God, a messenger of God, as they call pastors or this type of thing. If you're going around, you know, promoting these hate speeches, that's just my personal opinion on it. But it's also not any different than, you know, these people coming out with these, you know, pastors coming out with these speeches talking about, oh, we love everybody else except for gays. Or these people that's also coming out lately, just like the guy that made his speech at the university where he was saying something to the effect like, you know, this country was founded on the backs of white men. I'm like, no, it wasn't.
Oh, God, so I remember that, yeah.
It's just that thing. I think people are just trying to spread this, you know. I don't know. It's just weird. I don't know.
Well, the thing is, this is just symptomatic of the direction the country is going in with the election of Trump and everything. And she is part of that kind of groupthink about trying to take us back to 1958, basically, in the way the country thinks about everything about gay rights or women's rights or whatever kind of rights it might be. But in particular, she's talking about gays. And so I think that it is just, unfortunately, people believe in that shit. People believe in the hatred and the vitriol that these people espouse and believe that it's true. And therefore, that's why she's great. She's been raised to such a high level in her career or whatever, if you want to call it that. And because people believe this bullshit. And so people are going to continue to believe it, and people hate us because we're gay, and because I think that they have a right to hate us because they're gay, because I think it's divinely ordered, and some of them even believe that they should make us turn away from quote-unquote sin and change and all this bullshit.
But they have much bigger things to worry about than this.
Well, you would think that, right? I mean, put all the fucking effort you put into hating people into actually helping people, you know? Like, into helping the homeless or helping the elderly or whatever, the sick, infirm, whatever. I mean, it's just so fucking...
Right.
It's hypocritical, right?
It is. It's absolutely insane. And it's crazy. It's absolutely crazy, and I do not get it, and I understand why, you know, out of all things, I don't know why people just still feel so threatened by gays and lesbians in 2017. There are much more things to be worried about, like Trump, for example.
Well, the problem is they're all voting for him, too, so that's they don't worry about Trump. They vote for him.
But you know what? Someone, I was watching T.S. Madison, who, pretty sure there are a lot of people. T.S. Madison, she is a transgender, she does these videos on Facebook Live, that type of thing. I'm sure a lot of our listeners know.
No,
she's a grown woman.
Okay, I was thinking of who she. I was thinking of somebody else. Then go ahead. I was thinking of Jazz. That's who I was thinking of. Jazz. Go ahead.
No. This is a grown woman. So, she pretty much was saying that, she was disgusted by it and that type of thing. And she said, you know, she doesn't understand how all these black people in this church is like clapping and going along with it. Yes, God, praise God. Yes, mm-hmm. You're so right. And she was like, you know, she said pretty much saying they need to worry about more important things like Trump, because Trump is going to try to take away everything that involves black people. So, you know, whether it comes to, you know, and she was like, I understand this may hurt me, you know, in a sense or whatever. But she was just like, Trump is all y'all clapping and clapping and cheering about this shit right now. And y'all going to be the same ones with this defeat look on your face a few months from now when Trump gets in office. So, you know, it's like. Like, seriously, I mean, if you don't have anything good to say about it, here's my thing. When you are in the media, when you are in the mm-hmm. spotlight, there are certain things that you should not you know, say when you are in the public eye. Keep that, if you feel that way, keep it for kitchen table talk.
Why?
Keep that for when you're at home.
Why?
That type of thing.
No, I disagree with you. You know why? I want my bigotry out in the open. Where I can see it, because I like to know who the fucking bigots are. Because when people are going around and saying, like you're saying, the kitchen table talk,
well, I don't agree with.
I'm not saying you agree with it. I'm just saying that I don't agree with the fact that you're saying they should keep it to themselves or behind closed doors. I think I like it when bigots are open, because then I know who the fucking bigots are. I hate when people are all like, "Oh, hot, nice to your face. Hi, how are you, honey? How's things?" And "Oh, I love your partner, your husband, whatever." And then behind them closed, "Oh, those fucking faggots." You know, no. I like people to be upfront, and I like to know who the fucking bigots are. So for me, if you're going to be a fucking bigot, just be a bigot and be the best bigot you can be. That way I can know who the fuck to stay away from in the first place. So I like it that way.
Mm-hmm. Right. Well, I mean, that's just my thing.
Well, I respect the fact that this bitch is coming out and saying what she thinks, but what I don't respect is she's backtracking. I respect the fact that she thinks that, but not the fact that she's coming back and saying, "Oh, well, I didn't really say that," you know.
Right, and then the thing about Kim Burrell is that prior to this, I knew of Kim Burrell. I cannot tell you one particular gospel song by Kim Burrell. I didn't even know the bitch was from Texas up until today.
Yeah.
So I just knew of her within the gospel community, but amongst the black community as well.
Yeah.
But that was it. I don't know anything else about her beyond that. And, you know, but she's lost a lot of things. She's lost some endorsements. She has lost. She was featured on Frank Ocean's album. And now I think they're trying to remove her vocals from one of his songs. And then.
Well, he's gay.
Right. Exactly. So I was like, okay, you was okay taking that gay check.
This is the thing. Well, don't you think, Jason, also like people like T.D. Jakes, is that the pastor's name?
Right.
Potter House, whatever. People like that, like Oprah, when she kind of raised him up like she does, you know, she picks somebody and she makes them famous, like Nate Berkus or like Dr. Phil or whoever, or Ilanya or whatever. She makes, you know what I mean? She takes a project and she makes them somebody because with her power and stuff, because she believes in what their message is. So I have a problem. I don't like him. I just don't like him at all, because I have a problem with black preachers. And the reason I just told you earlier. And I think that it's because, you know, most of them, I consider them to probably most likely be homophobic people and hate gays, generally. Generally, that's what they... I'm not saying all of them.
Not like that.
No, I'm not talking about Ilanya. I'm talking about T.D. Jakes, him himself. Potter House is a very well-known, like, they're not a gay-friendly place. But anyway, what my point is that you have these people like her, Kim Burrell, or T.D. Jakes, or whomever it might be, and they're supposed to be preaching love and all this good stuff and whatever, yet all they do is focus on hatred. And that seems to be the modus operandi with most Christians these days. They don't seem to profess love and to adhere to the teachings of Christ, which is what the word Christianity means and comes from, instead they focus on judging people and hating people and telling people what to do and how to live their lives and telling everyone you have to live your life like me, otherwise you're evil. So to me, it seems like all these people are just a fucking waste of time, and they're basically charlatans. I think I consider them charlatans. They're not real people. They're just fake. So why do people follow that? Why, people are just brainwashed by religion so much that they have to follow what some pastor says?
So.
Really?
That's why I'm not involved in it. That's one of the reasons why I do not go to church, because certain African-American churches make it to the point, or just churches in general, just make it to the point where being gay is so wrong and such a sin, and it gets into the point where I feel like they purposely try to make it uncomfortable for gays and lesbians to attend church. That's why now you have, you know, churches who, you know, that are designed for gays and lesbians and bisexual and transgender, because I feel like the quote-unquote traditional church, they purposely try to do that to keep people away, because, you know, it's a lot of people who struggle with this every day. Some people, there are pretty people who are gay and don't want to be gay, but it is what it is.
But let's focus on the fact that the hypocrisy of it as well. I mean, and the fact that, or not the illogicalness or whatever of it, because let's say that everything that these Christian people, which I don't believe in any of this, by the way, I don't believe the Bible's true. I don't believe Jesus Christ even existed, by the way. But anyway, that's a whole other story. But let's just say that he did exist and all this is true. The Bible says this, blah, 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 blah. Let's say all that he said, he himself never said one word about gay people, not one. So if it's so fucking important, I think he would have mentioned it. But secondly, all the stuff around it in Leviticus and everything else that mentions about don't lay down with a man as a way with a woman, blah, blah, blah. Let's say all of that's true. Let's say that it's the truth. Why do these people who believe that being gay is a sin, or the act of being gay, as they put it usually, is a sin, focus on gay people so much when they have within their midst, and they don't want gay people around them to be in the parishioners or whatever, they have within their midst adulterers and thieves and liars and, you know what I mean, murderers sometimes. I mean, they have people who have done far worse things than being gay. Yet they focus all of their hatred and vitriol towards gay people and just get them out. We don't want them around us. They're disgusting, whatever. But they're fine with the thieves, the adulterers, and the murderers. You know what I mean?
And that's the same thing that T.S. Madison brought up in her video. She was like, I don't understand that you can have, you know, 9 kids by 9, you know, baby daddies, but Lord, don't ever be gay. You know,
right.
It's like, you know, it's
hypocrisy.
Crazy, I mean, it's insane. And I don't know. It's crazy. But,
it
you
is.
Know, this is going to – overall, I just want to move on because I'm sick of talking about it. But it's going to hurt her financial – oh, wait a minute. And before I move on, I want to say this. Well, this just came out today. So Pastor Shirley Caesar. Now, Shirley Caesar is a little bit more well-known in the gospel community.
Uh-huh.
Okay. So she's a little bit. She's much more well known in the gospel, in the African American gospel community. Shirley Caesar is pretty much like the Beyonce of gospel.
Yeah.
Like, seriously.
Yeah.
So she pretty much came out with a statement today, and I was reading it, and for a moment I was like, "Oh, Shirley Caesar speaking out against this. This is gonna be amazing."
No.
Child, then I read that shit. I was like, Shirley, I need you to go sit your ass down somewhere.
She said you, referring to Kimberell, should have said something 4 years ago when our president made that stuff all right.
She said that you should have said something 4 years ago before the president made this okay or something.
Made
that
stuff
nature.
All right, she says.
I'm like, Shirley, go sit your ass over in the corner and do not get up until I tell you.
This is why. Oh, okay, before we move on, I just want to say this. This is why I have such a difficult time being around so many people. And it's because there's so many different kinds of people in this world who don't like me because, you know, first of all, I'm biracial, so I got to deal with the black and white thing, and then the black thing in itself, and the white thing in itself, and the black and white thing in itself. And then I got to deal with the fact that I'm gay. And so I'm constantly, wherever I fucking go, I can't be around black people in general. I mean, like this kind of black people, I mean, because they are generally hate me because I'm gay, or they don't like me because I'm half white, or they don't, they think I'm too, act too white or act too black, whatever. There's always something wrong with me because I'm don't fit in there. And when it's around, you know, people who are white people, it's, you know, a bunch of rednecks can't be around them for the same reason. And a bunch of religious people can't be around them because I don't believe in any of that bullshit. And so I get so fucking tired of always having to couch myself and change what, you know, I don't do it, but people expect me to do it, to be different just so other people are comfortable. And so that's just why I don't hang around many people. I have a very small select group of people that I hang around in friendships and things because I just don't fit anywhere. I never
well,
have.
I'm the same way. I'm the exact same way. I've been told that I am the whitest black guy that someone has ever met. I have been told that, oh, it's almost like you're not black. I was like, what does that even mean? And then I was told that someone told me something years ago when I first graduated college, and something to the, I'm paraphrasing here, but it was something to the effect like, oh, you must be college educated because you speak very proper, or you speak very eloquently, or something of that nature. And I was like,
but that's a cultural bias. That's what that
but,
is.
But I was like, but there are plenty of people who, you know, speak proper and don't have college degrees. So it's like, you know, I'm like,
what's also, like, and also, it, I mean, also, I mean, yeah, I understand what you're saying, and I'm
like, is that a compliment? Should I like, should I be, a, should I take this as a compliment to be offended?
I think both. I think both, actually. I think you should take it both ways, actually. Yeah, and the other group of people for me is like people who are like I've always even when I was a kid I like nice shit, I like nice stuff no matter what it was, I like nice things, I'm a nice, I just have good taste, I can't help that, it's just that's one reason I do what I do for a living too, but I like nice things, and so I've always, you know, if I'm around people who are poor or not wealthy, then they try to make me feel bad for having nice things or wanting nice things. When I'm around people who are wealthy, they try to make you feel bad for trying to, like, not, what's the word, trying to be more, like, down to earth. I don't know how to explain it. And so it's like, no matter where you fucking go, you can't please anybody. And so I just say, just be yourself, whoever the fuck you are, and don't give a fuck what people say, especially people like fucking Shirley Caesar and Kim Burrell. Nobody gives a fuck about these bitches anyway. Right. The people who give a fuck about these bitches, we don't give a fuck about anyway. So who the fuck cares? Right. Just move
exactly.
It on.
Exactly. But that must have been whoever recorded it. There was one person who was against it because he or she was recording that shit. They knew whoever was recording it knew they were going to put this out to the public. So there must have been one person who was there and was like,
this is wrong.
I don't know
yeah.
about this.
Mm-hmm. So, good for them. Good for you, whoever you were. So
yeah.
Next topic. Let's talk about the woman who was kicked out of JCPenney after being told she didn't belong there.
Yes. Okay. So here's the thing. This is the second time within the past 2 or 3 weeks that JCPenney has been in the news. Mm-hmm. Remember the a few, maybe it was last show or the show before. Where
was that Target or JCPenney, the other one?
That was JCPenney.
Oh,
yeah,
it
we
was.
Thought it was Target. It was JCPenney.
Oh, wow.
So remember when the two Hispanic women were there and
right.
the white lady was like, you know, you need to go right back where the fuck you came from? That pissed me off. So now in Indiana, there was a African-American shopper. She was shopping just like, you know, everyone else does. For some reason, she was told that she was asked to leave the store because she, quote unquote, did not belong there. Now, she was shopping. She, you know, wasn't doing anything, any type of criminal activity. So when, and this is a store employee that confronted her, okay?
Yeah.
So then when the store employee confronted her, she really did, you know, she paid it. She was like, motherfucker, please, and kept shopping, right? So the store employee takes it upon himself. This is where I feel like I don't understand why employees feel like they should take matters into their own hands and, you know, try to do this type of thing. So when she refused to leave, she kept shopping. This is a woman now. A man who was employed put a woman in a headlock in the store and held on to her until security arrived. Now, there were people around here, white, black, all races, was like, what are you doing that for? She hasn't done anything and that type of thing. There's a video online where you
right.
can look this up.
Yeah.
And he kept saying, well, if you back up, I'll let her go. But he never let her go. Okay. So the security shows up. This must have been like as I was watching the video, they said that her dad came to get her. So this must have been someone who was maybe like in their late teens, early 20s. Mm-hmm. But they took her to, you know, the security booth at the mall or whatever. And then once her dad came and got her, they just let her go. So I was like, okay, what was the whole point of you putting her fucking headlock then?
The man.
And I guarantee you, I'm a follower of this story. I guarantee you they're going to sue JCPenney because of this.
Well, they should. The man, the problem with these security guards is, first of all, they're barely trained at all. And secondly, the
ones... I didn't think he was a security guard. In the video, he looked like he was just in regular street clothing.
Oh, you don't think he worked for that company?
No, they say he was an employee, but he wasn't a security
guard. Oh, he was just an employee? Oh, my God. I didn't realize that. I thought he was a security guard or something.
No, he was an employee.
Oh, my God. The man obviously has issues with either black people or women or both, and obviously just took this opportunity to take his frustrations out on this woman. I mean, obviously he's got mental issues. No one would normally do that, especially when she wasn't doing anything wrong and she was just walking around. And if he really wanted to apprehend her so that the security people or whoever he said he was waiting for to get there, police, whatever, could do something. She was going to continue to shop in the store. He could have just watched her. He didn't have to actually, you know, physically touch her. He could have watched her. She's walking around. She wasn't leaving. So what the fuck did he need to do that for? Nothing. People, right.
And,
go ahead.
And then the thing was is that also when they asked her to leave several times, I guess there was like a tussle or a scuffle or something of that nature, and she accidentally knocked over a stand in the process or some type of display or something. And broke the display, but it was an accident. It wasn't like she purposely did it. So I guess whoever then just, you know, put her in a headlock, because I guess they assumed she did it on purpose.
Yes.
So, and they just put her in a headlock, and I'm like, listen, see, this shit like this, and I understand this is a man versus a woman, so it looks like the woman in the video was trying to get this man off her, but she probably couldn't just because he was probably so much stronger than her.
She kept saying, what are you doing? What are you doing? And they were saying, what are you doing? What are you doing?
Right. So
it
was just weird, but I don't know what's going on with JCPenney. They've been fucking up for the past few weeks, just like another person we're going to get on in just a moment. But... You know, JCPenney, y'all need to get together. Y'all need to screen your employees a little bit better, or y'all need to have, you know, retrain them if certain situations happen. Just call the police, not try to take shit in your own hands. Because here's my thing: what happens if there was a different type of woman? She had a gun on her and she felt threatened and shot him. Then they would have turned the tables and be like, oh, well, you know, then she would have been pressed. You know, then they would have arrested her for, you know, murder, even though she was the one being attacked. Like,
yeah, well, of course, especially because she's black, so they would have definitely arrested her.
And my thing is, why would you attack a stranger not knowing what they have on you? People carry knives and guns on them all the time.
People who do this kind of thing don't think about that stuff. They don't care. They don't use their brain.
So if I would have had a 380 and I felt threatened because you have me in a headlock, I truly feel threatened because you have a headlock, and I pull out a pistol out my, you know, holster on my thigh and shoot your ass, now all of a sudden I'm the angry black guy, right?
Well, we know what happened with Trayvon Martin, so probably, unfortunately, yes. It's not fair, but that's probably what would happen, especially in Texas. Welcome to America.
And then after that, they probably still throw my ass in prison.
Oh, probably, yeah, probably. It's fucking, the world, the fucking, the South is the most unjust place in the world.
Well, this wasn't in the South, though.
Well, I'm talking about you, if you were to do that here. Well, yeah. But yes, wherever it was, America in general.
That's just America in general.
Yeah,
now.
It's just unjust. It just always has been. And it's going
and
that direction. Go ahead.
And speaking of companies who've been in the spotlight for the past few weeks, Delta motherfucking Airlines, they in the spotlight once again. Delta... whoever the CEO is of Delta, I need you, he or she, to come on down, and I need you to do some type of investigation with the company, because it's just too much stuff going on. First, you had the incident with the person having a heart attack on the plane, and then the black woman said that she was a nurse. The flight attendant, to believe her, told her to go sit her black ass back down, pretty much what they told her. Then the white guy, yeah, they just happily took him, didn't ask him for no credentials, no nothing.
Right.
Then Delta Airlines also got in trouble because a woman was wearing an afro, and they kicked her off the plane because they said her afro was being somewhat like offensive. I don't know how hair is offensive, but then they
they say relaxers for white people. It's not really for black people. Makes them more relaxed. Yeah. That's what they say. Go ahead.
And then there was also the guy who was speaking Arabic to his friends on a flight.
Right.
And it turns out that this guy was also like a YouTube star or something like that. And he said something to one of his friends in Arabic, and someone got so offended and said that they were some distraught white woman fearing for her life, and got kicked off the plane, kicked all of them off the plane. It was like four of them. And then when he was recording it, remember we talked about this, like we were recording
it?
Yeah. And, you know, this type of thing. And they were like, bye, get your ass off the plane or something like that. Now you have this situation. Two women are suing Delta Airlines because their mentor, I guess these were like flight attendants, I guess they were in training, and their mentor was openly masturbating in front of them.
That's now, disgusting. On the plane?
I don't think it was on the plane. I think it was like at one of their like lounge terminals at one of these airports or something like that.
Uh-huh.
You know, where they go in and rest and, you know, that type of thing. And it's just like, Delta, what the fuck are y'all doing? Like, what are y'all doing?
Well, obviously there is an issue at Delta, obviously, because it keeps happening at Delta. Delta's based in Atlanta, I think, by the way.
They are.
And
I'm not flying Delta. First of all, Delta Airlines, their tickets are too fucking expensive.
Well, I got to say, when I went to see Madonna in January, I flew Delta, and that's the only time I've ever flown Delta. I've always flown American Airlines or Southwest once or twice. I hate Southwest, but anyway. And I got to say, I came back and I said my experience on Delta was a hell of a lot better than it was ever was on American. So that, for me, I think it's a better airline, but I don't know about the racism thing. So
it's crazy, though. I mean, it's insane. So these two women are suing for $5 million. And you know what? Honestly, just based on the previous shit that Delta Airlines has done to these various people, I hope these two women get it.
I do too. You know how somebody else I hope gets it is Mariah Carey, because I hope she gets it.
Oh, my God. My God.
Let's talk about that whole tobacco at New Year's Eve.
Yes. Go ahead and go, because I have a lot of things I can say about
this. Well, I just wanted to say, I mean, you know what happened? If you don't know what happened, Mariah Carey was attempting to sing, kind of, at New Year's Eve, Rockin' Eve or whatever, over the New Year's Eve weekend. And she began singing, and apparently she couldn't hear herself or something, and her earpiece. And so rather than being a professional like Madonna or Adele or a million other people, this has happened to a bazillion times on people.
Beyonce.
And being a professional.
Got a fucking fan and kept singing.
Yeah, and just belting it out or saying something about it and saying, I can't hear myself, can you please start over, or something. She just stands there like a fucking moron. And I'm waiting, basically, and never fucking sings. And she just ruined the whole fucking thing and ends up walking off the fucking stage. Didn't she walk off the stage? I thought she walked off the stage at the end.
No, she stayed on the stage. You know, she had those men to keep carrying up and down the fucking
stage. Yeah, it was so stupid. They were like, the guys were like doing the moves behind her, and while she was just standing there. It was so dumb.
And one of the guys really tried to help her at one point, and, you know, bits and pieces.
Yeah.
But here's my thing, though. Now, I talked to a friend of mine who is an artist, okay? Now, she said
what kind of artist?
You perform live and you have background dancers, the background dancers are going off what they hear on the speakers, which clearly what they were doing.
She has a different mic.
But exactly. And then she was also telling me that, but when the artist is performing, sometimes there's a slight delay, even though it's syncing up with the music and the speakers, there's a slight delay or something of that nature. I'm not an artist, so I really don't know. I should have had her on a show, but I didn't think about that at the time.
Well,
but
you know, they have to not only the earpiece, they hear the music, they also hear their own microphone. So
right.
She hears herself through the microphone, and then she hears the music. So I don't know if she could. She said she couldn't hear herself, so I guess she couldn't hear her microphone. She could hear the music, or vice versa, or
right.
Not both. I don't know which.
Right, but my thing is, like, you know, the dancers didn't skip a beat, so I don't understand exactly what she was talking about.
That's what I'm saying. They're listening to different tracks. I mean, the same track, but different feeds. That's what I'm trying to say.
So the thing is that it was weird to me because it was like, and it seemed like she was like for the first few seconds she was kind of looking for the earpiece. I guess it was like tangled in the hair or some shit.
Yeah.
And then I said, then that's why you need to stop wearing them long ass extensions, Mariah. case in point right there.
Yeah.
So then she was looking for it, and then she kind of stopped and just stood there and was just like, oh. But here's my thing. Mariah has been performing. I have been listening to Mariah since I was literally a kid, okay? I feel like if you've been in the music game for over 20 years, you should have known what to do in a situation like that. There are too many. I feel like as a seasoned performer, you should have told them to stop the music and do this shit.
Well, especially since it happened to her last year at Rockefeller Center. I don't know if you recall this, but last year at Rockefeller Center, she was doing a live performance, and the same thing happened. She said, I can't hear myself on my mic, blah, 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 blah. And so I begin to question whether this is really due to technical difficulties or if she's just using it as an excuse because she can't sing. I mean, I know she could sing, but to me, it feels like she's just fucking lazy. And she doesn't do her warm-up. She doesn't do her practice or anything. She just wants to get out there and sing and collect her check and go home. That's what it seems like to me.
And Dick Clark Productions said that she pretty much did. She pretty much did a half-ass sound check.
Well, there you go.
You know, that type of thing. But here's my thing. You are a seasoned performer. You tell me out of 20-something years, this has never happened to you to where your sound loses and you... I mean, come on. I've seen Madonna on stage. She tell them, stop the track, stop the music. We're going to do this shit over. I need sound check first to come up here. There was a clip just going on the other day. She was like, I need to know why the fuck I can't hear it.
That's right, because that's how she is.
Like, right in the middle of a concert.
Because she's not going to pretend like there's nothing going wrong. That's what stupid Mariah was just pretend like, oh, there's nothing wrong. I'm just going to stand here and bump.
And then you had Fantasia. Fantasia track. It wasn't syncing up with the music or whatever. She told the band to stop playing, and she did that shit a cappella.
Because she can sing, yes.
Exactly. And then you had Beyonce. Beyonce then fell off of motherfucking stage. She just said they got her hair caught in a fan. This bitch even had her earring ripped out and was bleeding and was still performing on stage. So, Mariah, like, what was your fucking excuse?
She's just lazy. She's always been like that. She's just lazy.
I mean, you could see Beyonce physically bleeding on TV.
I know. I know.
Walking around and singing. I'm like, bitch, you a trooper. Because I don't know if I would have done all that. But, you know, hey, you want to put on a good show? You want to let them know that, hey, you still stand it? And I commend her for that. But
I do too. Well, I just think that if you're a professional or consummate performer, you would just know what to do, like you said earlier. And it seems to me, we know that she's been doing this forever, like you said, and it doesn't make any sense that she wouldn't know what to do in that situation or act like she didn't know what to do. Or like, oh, I think, you know what I think it is? I think part of it is, this is just a feeling I have. Because I've seen some of her show or whatever, and I've just, you know, seen the criticisms about her the past few years. And, like, after the Rockefeller Center thing last year, I think she was standing there thinking, oh, my God, I can't believe this is fucking happening again if this really was a technical difficulty. And she did not know how last time it happened, they played back her vocal without the music. And it was like, you know what I mean?
Horrible.
It was horrible. Yeah. And so I think I think in the back of her mind, she's thinking, oh, God, now people are going to think I can't sing or whatever. And she can't, but so she's just got up there. I think she panicked is my point. I think she panicked. And I think she didn't know what the fuck to do because she didn't want to seem like she wasn't singing because she wasn't singing. Some of it she was singing, but there was a backup track there.
Well, she did the first song she did Emotions. And Emotions, it was mainly just the music track with a few background vocals
in there. Right. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And then she performed We Belong Together. Now, We Belong Together, she lip-synced to that. Now, I feel like, here's my thing with the song We Belong Together. When she was lip-syncing to that, she still had a chance to save herself at that point, right? But instead of just lip-syncing and going on with the track, first of all, when I heard it, I was like, bitch, this is a studio track. I can tell the difference between a studio track and a live version.
Yeah.
That was clearly a studio
track.
But I was like, you know what? I said, if she's singing live, she's doing awful pretty damn good because I'm like, that shit sounds a lot like a studio version. But anyway, she was singing along to the track, lip syncing to it, and she did fine for like the first 15 seconds. I was like, okay, you still can save yourself. Then she literally just put the mic down and just walked. I'm like, girl, what are you doing? Like, why would you lip sync 15 seconds into your song? You take the mic down, your vocals are still going. It's like, at that point, I was like, you could tell that she was just over it. She was over it at that point. I was just like.
That's what I was talking about earlier. I thought she just walked off the stage, and that's what I was talking about.
No, but at the very end, she said, you know, you know, it just doesn't get any better or something like that. And she just stormed up the stage. You can tell by her body language, she was over it. She looked defeated. She looked like she was about to cry at one point. I mean, and then she said that Dick Clark Productions tried to sabotage her performance. And Dick Clark Productions was like, oh, no, bitch. You're not going to throw our name under the
bus. Why would they do that? They want to put on a good show. They don't want to fuck it up. I guess, for publicity, she's saying.
Right. And then, and then Dick Clark Productions came out with a statement and said, oh, no. You're not going to do that to our name. Mm. So they pretty much came out with a statement and said that, pretty much paraphrasing, they were saying something to their words like, we would never try to sabotage an artist's performance. That's not what we do, that type of thing. And they did say that she did not do a full sound check, which is pretty much translation for this bitch did the shit half-ass, was out there for about 10 minutes, and, you know, did a few notes and then walked off stage and said, okay, let's do it.
Well, whatever. People are saying Mariah's over.
And this whole diva thing with her is really starting to annoy the fuck out of me, because they had some clips of her during rehearsal, and I guess when the dancer is like her supposed new boyfriend now, we already know this shit ain't gonna last long, okay? She's stopped, and then he's holding her cell phone, and he has the cell phone up to her ear, because I guess this bitch is just, you know, so diva, like she can't hold her own fucking cell phone while she's talking to it. It's like, girl, give that diva shit a rest. It's like, the only way Mariah's going to save herself at this point, bitch, you got to perform the next 10 shows for free around the country. Like, that's the only way you're going to save yourself. Because right now, Mariah, this is not a good look for you, and people are really giving you some serious side eye right now. This may be the end of your career, as you know it. Because let's be honest, real talk. Ain't no one been checking for Mariah Carey since that album, The Emancipation of Mimi, and that came out 3,000 years ago. So, honestly, that was like back in 2005. Ain't nobody been checking for Mariah Carey since, me being one of them. I'm just being honest. That's the last album I bought for Mariah Carey. Mariah Carey came out about 2-3 more albums, and they all sound like pure shit, okay? So, girl, please, you need to hang it up.
So well, I don't know if she's done. I don't think she's done. I don't think she's. I don't think she's done because she's too big of a talent, and when she actually can sing, the problem I feel like is that she just doesn't care anymore, and like she's just got, like you said, this whole diva act down, this bullshit. And honestly, this diva thing really, to me, in my opinion, alienates her from her fans and doesn't really endear her to most of them. I think instead of making her seem like, you know, some goddess or something or whatever she's trying to make herself out to be, to me it's more like she's unattainable and not really part of the people or whatever. And so I think she's doing herself a disservice by being that way, and I think she just needs to sit down and actually work on her music the way she once did in the 90s and stuff. She doesn't have to sound the same kind of music or whatever, but she had good quality music in those days because she worked on it. You could tell early 2000s too. It's just that she's fucking lazy. She's given up. She's like, I don't want to fucking work. I just want to phone it in every time she does a show or anything. And that's what she's doing. So I think it's up to her if she wants to have a comeback or not. But like, there's only so many chances the public's going to give you. And
here's my thing.
She's exhausting.
If your heart is not in it anymore, you have three options, Mariah. You can announce to the media or to the public that you're going to retire. You're going to come up with one last album. Lord knows if it does well or not. I don't know. And then so you're going to hang it up and spend more time with your children. Or you can take 5 years off and get yourself together and try to come out with a bomb-ass album. Or just stop being with these diva antics. Like, girl, like, that shit was cute, like, in the 90s and early 2000s. Like, girl, it's 2017. Mm-hmm. Like, that diva shit, you may think it's cute, but at the end of the day, it's making you look like a total bitch.
Right.
So it's like, girl, stop. Like, Mariah, have several seats.
Let's talk about Lee Daniels.
This motherfucker. So, of course, for you, you guys who don't know, Lee Daniels is the writer and creator and director for several shows and movies such as Precious. I think he had written and directed that. He also is over Empire, which is a great show. I love that. Now he has a new show called Star, which follows Empire. It comes on right after Empire. And he pretty much has, I think it stars Queen Latifah and, what's that man's name? He's been in a jillion movies and I can't remember his name. But pretty much, he made a statement where he said he made the lead of the show star. He made the lead white because he wanted white people to feel good about themselves being white. Now, of course, it sparked a ton of controversy when he said that. Because people were just like, well, why do you have to make a white lead? Why did you make the lead white so that white people can feel good about themselves? White people already feel good about themselves every day. I mean, it was funny, but I was just like, I kind of see where they're coming from with this. But I just want, why would you say something like that? Because you want the white people good feel good about being white. I didn't quite under it was when I first heard it was funny but yet kind of confusing at the same time.
Well, I don't know what that means. I guess he wants them to feel.
He wants a white audience.
Not guilty. I mean, he just wants them to not feel guilty about black or Hispanic or Asian oppression throughout the 600 or 400 years of this country or whatever.
Well, then he should came up with a better phrase, because to say to make white people feel good about being white, I'm like, there's already plenty of that going on.
I know that, and I get that. I'm just saying I'm trying to figure out where he's coming from. I don't understand what else he's – how. I mean, what is he – I don't know. I don't get that at all. I don't know.
I didn't get it either, and a lot of people were confused by it too. They were just like,
he didn't say anything after that to confirm.
He pretty much came out with a rebuttal afterwards, not a rebuttal, but more like an additional statement afterwards. But he pretty much just said the same thing again. He was like, well, you know, I came with the lead. I feel like he said that I think his delivery and his wording might not have been correct, but I feel like when it all boils down, he's trying to get. Capture the white audience, because I know with Empire he has predominantly the black audience, I'm gonna say the minority audience, because it seems like a lot of minorities watch Empire. You know, I work with a lot of people who are Asian, Hispanic, Indian, and so on and so on, and a lot of them watch Empire, but when it comes to white individuals, it's only like a small percentage that watches Empire. So maybe he came up with the show to try to capture the white audience. That's the only thing that I can think of.
Maybe.
But, you know.
That's a weird way to go about it, though.
What was that?
It's a weird way to go about it.
But, I mean, that could be true, though.
I'm just saying it's a weird way for him to do that.
Precious was a great movie. It was.
I'm not saying it's not true that he wants a white audience. I'm saying that's a weird way for him to go about getting one, is to say. He wants to make white people feel good about themselves. It's just odd.
Well, yeah. I don't agree with it either. But, you know, I mean, since the show has debuted, I think it's two or three episodes in. This is the first season. I have not watched any of it. And it's not because Queen Latifah's in it, and I absolutely love Queen Latifah. But it's just not a show that really has caught my attention. I did watch a sneak peek, and it seemed okay. But it wasn't anything that really just would be like I would just race home and, you know, want to watch this as airing. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
So, and that's the same thing with a lot of shows now. Like Housewives of Atlanta, I feel the same way about that now. But,
okay.
I mean, you know, it is what it is. So Lee Daniels, I just wish you would have came out and said something different. But hey,
I think it's weird. But whatever. Before we go, let's talk about, I guess, Serena Williams real quick.
So Serena Williams has officially been engaged. I love me some Serena Williams, okay? Serena Williams is like the friend in my head, even though I've never met this bitch, I probably never will. I just absolutely love everything about her. So over the past week, she was engaged, or she is engaged, to the founder of Reddit. I had his name up, but I somehow lost it. But pretty much he's the founder. If you just Google the founder of Reddit, his name's going to pop up. And he's a white male, and of course she's a black female. And of course, here we go with the race. People just like, why is she engaged to a white man? And I'm like, oh my God, are we like.
I mean,
people can't be engaged to someone of a different race or truly be in love with someone of a different race and just be happy. I was just truly happy for her. I was just like. But there were so many people online that was just like, I'm happy for an all, but really a white man? I'm like.
Can I, let's say something. I want to say a couple things about that. First of all, Serena Williams is very wealthy, and she is surrounded by a lot of really wealthy people, black, white, whatever. But and the wealthier you are because of our oppressive society, the fewer black people you're going to be around. That's just the way it is, the way the society's made. And there's fewer black people in general. And then
well, not so much black people. I think it is that you just or either just poor people in general. You're just not going to just relate to them like that.
Well, I know, but the point I'm making is there's going to be fewer black people because there are fewer black people anyway in the statistics of society in this country. And therefore, there's going to be fewer black wealthy people on her same level, other than other celebrities or whatever. So she's going to be surrounded. But my point is, her the pond she has to draw from, what she's surrounded by most of the time, is mostly going to be white people or people who are, whatever. And so that's probably my point is, it's more likely she's going to end up with someone who's white if she wants someone who's on the same financial level as she is. I'm not saying that there aren't black people who are just as wealthy. I'm just saying that generally that odds would be that. That's the first thing. The second thing is, people who have a problem with people who date other races have an issue with themselves. Well, fuck them. Who gives a fuck what people think like that? I mean, I'm a product of a biracial, an interracial relationship, and I am here because of they loved each other, and they in the 60s and I mean, like, excuse me, the early late 70s they were together, and they had a really hard time about it because people were so fucking stupid and racist, especially in a small town in Texas where they were from. So I can't believe now, still in 2016, people still have a fucking issue with it. And if you have an issue with it, you're fucking racist. I don't care if you're black, white, Asian, whatever, you're fucking racist. So just fucking right. Own your racism and be a fucking, I mean, right. Who the fuck cares? We're all fucking human. We are all human. We're right. All the same exactly. Race. It's the human race.
Exactly. We all bleed the same people at the end of
it's
the day.
It's so fucking stupid. It's just stupid. I mean, talk about things to be upset about. Much more important, like talking about the environment or something like that. But when it comes to who you're dating, like the color of someone's skin, you know what I mean? Or very minor physical characteristics that make us different. It's like less than 0.1% of our DNA is different, and that's all based on appearance. Nothing else about us is different. It's all based on our hair color or texture or skin color, that kind of thing. That's it. Bone structure, maybe. That's right. It. So, I mean, it's so fucking stupid. I mean, you have a problem with things that don't make sense. This makes sense to me to be racist. It just doesn't make any sense, but whatever.
Right.
Logically, it's stupid.
Exactly. And then there's another story I want to discuss. There's actually two more stories I want to discuss. But
well, hurry up.
So there is a, there have been charges filed for a hate crime against four teenagers who kidnapped and tortured a mentally disabled teenager. So they pretty much tied him up and tormented him and assaulted him, and he was had like some type of mentally disabled or something like that, and he was reported missing. These kids were like 17, 18 years old. This happened in Chicago, I believe. And I'm just like, and then what made matter worse, they posted it on Facebook Live. Okay. So I guess when they posted on Facebook Live, people started watching and saw what was going on and notified the police. So, and they were saying something like, fuck white people, fuck Trump, yada, yada, yada. So pretty much these were just some racists. Because I'm like, you happen to just go and kidnap this random white guy that, is mentally disabled. And then you assault him. He has a gash in his head. He's bleeding from his head. You're kicking him in the head and that type of thing, and you're saying, fuck white people, fuck Trump. Like, what was the whole point in that? I don't understand the whole point in that. Like, well, because are you upset because Trump is in office? And see, and these are the same type of people who are so upset that Trump is in office. These are the same motherfuckers that probably didn't even go out and vote. So it's like, I don't understand what was your whole point in doing all this and taking the man and, putting a deep gash in his head to where he had to get like 70 or 80 stitches in his head. And it's like, and then he's reported missing. So technically that's kidnapping. So it's like your life is over before it even started. Cause I mean, you're 17, 18 years old, still in school, and you did this. And it's like, I don't like what is the world coming to? It's like, people just don't care about human life anymore. They just don't care about any of that anymore. And it's like, it's exhausting and disgusting, and I couldn't even watch all of the video because it was so bad. But I don't know. I'm just at loss of words with this whole situation.
Well, okay. Next. What's your last topic?
And then my last topic is British singer Rebecca Ferguson is going to be performing at the Trump inauguration.
Who is that?
She is a African American.
Oh, that one, the black one. Yeah. Okay.
Yeah. She was, I think she was the runner-up on the UK's X Factor. Mm-hmm. But she says she will only perform if she can perform, I think it's
Strange
called
Strange Fruit. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, Strange Fruit, which Billie Holiday performed, mm-hmm. Which talks about oppression.
Yeah, segregation in the South and black people.
And mm-hmm. I guess Trump people would just gave her the green light and said, okay. So really, at the end of the day, the joke's on them.
So they actually said yes? I heard about this. But they already said yes to her?
I'm assuming so. Last time I read, they said yeah.
They're idiots.
Trump people said yeah.
They're idiots.
I'm like, okay. I said, in that case, Rebecca Ferguson, you go out there and sing the hell out that song.
Well, hopefully she does. Good for her. We'll be back next week. Thursday, January the 12th. I think that's right. Let me see the 12th. I think it's the 12th. Yeah, the 12th. And we'll be back. If you want to talk to us, then we'll be here. If you want to find out more about us, you can go to GAYXYZ.com, MeOffLimitsShow.com. If you want to find out more about Jason, you can tweet him at.
You can tweet me at on Twitter, which is Jason B. Like. It's Jason. _ BBE _ like. And you can also follow me on Instagram because I finally have an Instagram. Yay. My Instagram is fireandice2013. Fire just like something's on fire. A-N-D. And then ice as in, you know, ice water. 2013.
Yeah, I noticed that the other day. Yeah, cool. Or today. All right. Well, we'll be back next week. Everybody have a great week and happy new year. And we will see you next time. And stay gay.
Happy New Year, everyone. Stay gay, motherfuckers. Yeah.
Bye.